Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Dana Schultz. I'm the program coordinator at the Greenwich Village Society for Historic Preservation. Before we get started, if I can ask everyone to please silence or turn off their cell phones. I'd like to very much thank the New School for Public Engagement for co-sponsoring this program with us and for hosting us this evening in their lovely space. If you'd like more information about the New School for Public Engagement and the other programs that they put on, you can get that right outside where you signed in. There's also an email sign-in list for them out there as well, and the same goes for us, the Greenwich Village Society. We have literature and an email sign-in sheet out there as well. As many of you may know, GVSHP is a nonprofit organization that works to preserve and educate about the architectural and cultural history of Greenwich Village, the East Village, and NoHo. Besides hosting educational lectures and tours such as these, we offer an in-class education program to elementary and middle school students and work to maintain and extend the historic district protections and appropriate zoning designations for our neighborhoods. Our work is largely supported and made possible by our members. If you'd like more information about what we do and how to become a member, like I said, that's all outside on the sign-in table, so I encourage you to find out more about us. It is now my pleasure to introduce tonight's panelists. I'll start with Tricia Laughlin Bloom, who's right here closest to me. She's the project curator of contemporary art at the Brooklyn Museum. Tricia joined the Brooklyn Museum in April of 2011 as project curator for the exhibition Hide Seek, Difference and Desire in American Portraiture. In 2012, Tricia organized the exhibitions Keith Haring, 1978 to 1982, and Question Bridge, Black Males, at the Brooklyn Museum. Previously, Tricia worked in the American Arts Department at the Newark Museum, where she helped organize the traveling exhibition Constructive Spirit, Abstract Art in South and North America, 1920s to 50s. She has served as a consultant to the Contemporary Indigenous Arts Program at the National Museum of the American Indian and has taught courses on modern and contemporary art at the New School and at Rutgers University. Tricia has an MA in Art History and Criticism from SUNY Stony Brook and a PhD in 20th Century Art from Rutgers. Our next speaker is Patti Astor. Ms. Astor is known as the queen of the downtown scene. She moved to the East Village in 1976 and went on to star in over 14 beyond low-budget films, among them Wild Style, Underground USA, and The Foreigner. Her films are in the permanent collections of the Whitney Museum, Museum of Modern Art, and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She went on to start the Fun Gallery with partner Bill Stelling, the first gallery in the East Village and the first gallery to give one-man shows to graffiti artists. On any one night from 1981 through 1985, you could get down with the Fun Gallery crew, Fab Five Freddy, Keith Haring, Futura, am I saying that right? Jean-Michel Basquiat, Dondi, Lee, Kenny Scharf, and Zephyr hanging with Rocksteady crew. Afrika Bambaataa, Clash, Leo Castelli, the Beastie Boys as bratty teens, Johnny Rotten, Julian Schnabel, Matt Dillon, Andy Warhol, and Madonna. Patti is here in New York to celebrate the publication of her book, Fun Gallery, The True Story, at Click Gallery on Saturday, October 6th. Last but certainly not least, I'd like to introduce Hal Bromm. Mr. Bromm, art dealer, designer, real estate developer, and historic preservation professional, is one of the pioneers of Tribeca, a thriving community created by the adaptive reuse of historic mercantile buildings. He is the owner of Hal Bromm Gallery, the first commercial contemporary gallery to open in Tribeca in 1976, which is known for discovering new talent well ahead of the curve, presenting Keith Haring's first New York exhibition in 1981. Bromm has curated exhibits of cutting-edge contemporary art at numerous venues and is an art advisor to contemporary collections, both private and public. He has been involved in historic restoration and design projects both in the United States and abroad, ranging from restaurants and hotels to private residences. In 1984, Hal formed the Committee for the Washington Market Historic District, to save Tribeca's architectural heritage by lobbying the New York City Landmarks Preservation Commission to designate the area an historic district. The 1991 to 1993 designations of the Tribeca West, North, South, and East historic districts have helped preserve one of America's most historically important urban mercantile and market centers, containing an unprecedented collection of 19th century commercial architecture. Tribeca's Renaissance has become a national model of successful adaptive reuse in an urban center. Now please join me in welcoming all of our speakers this evening. The way that this evening is going to be formatted is each of the panelists will give a short presentation individually, and then that'll be followed by a question and answer where there will be more of a discussion. Tricia is going to start us off this evening.
Hello, and thank you, Dana, and New School and Greenwich Village Historical Society for putting together this great program. I'm going to talk about Keith's work and how interesting it is, I think, that more than any other contemporary artist, his work seems to embody the life of New York City during this time period, the late 70s, early 80s, when downtown New York really had such a flourishing and a renaissance. And the fact that he comes from rural Pennsylvania at the age of 20 in 1978, not knowing anybody in New York City, and very shortly finds himself at the burgeoning heart of what's happening in the East Village and the rest of the New York art world, is extraordinary. And the short time frame in which he did so much still remains to be really well documented and fleshed out. I wanted to start with this work because I think it really captures, again, Keith, the unique individual that he was, again, a really kind of ordinary-looking, regular guy, not a flashy, stereotypical art star personality. And this piece, which is a series of Polaroids that he shot over the course of 3 years in collaboration with Kenny Scharf, really captures, again, the way that he came to New York and just totally embraced it, became a part of the life of the city. So this is just a sampling of a long series in which Keith put on a different pair of Kenny Scharf glasses, and I have to add that some of the glasses were painted by Peter Scheuf for accuracy, and took these photographs around New York City. So in putting the show together, we included some of the original Polaroids, and there's just these nice notations on the back in Keith's handwriting saying, you know, where he was, and, you know, for instance, this is tripping in Times Square. We have, you see him with in front of Picasso show, the making of one of his video pieces in 1980. So really kind of a snapshot, literally and figuratively, of the person and the city that he loved. So again, he came to New York to attend the School for Visual Arts and immediately was really just quite ready for that environment of intensive studio practice and mentorship with some of the leading artists of the time. So what is so unique, I think, about Keith's work is the extreme interdisciplinarity of it, the way he embraced and was influenced by street art, graffiti, as well as punk and new wave music and performance art and headier subjects like art history and semiotics. He just took it all in like a sponge. He was so ready for it. And his work is very much a response to and an embodiment of what he was experiencing in the city. And again, he spent his time going to nightclubs, museums, studio practice, the club baths where he could really embrace and enjoy the freedom of being a gay man in New York City in 1978. so again, part of what makes him so, I think, accessible and so effective and so compelling as an artist, especially during these early years, is the way in which he ranged from the very personal to the more mythical and universal messages that would reach a really, really broad audience. So you see the work on the left is part of a series of drawings that just
celebrate, again, his experience, which was very phallic, very sexual, very much about coming into his own in a very free and open gay community and going out to clubs every night, and that the pulse of the dance floor, the syncopation of the subways, all of that gets incorporated into his imagery. And one of the things that is really continuous, I think, throughout his work, too, is this really obsessive interest in pattern. So the work on the left, which is from the series Manhattan Penis Drawings for Ken Hicks, and if you're familiar with this series, it really is this merging of the cityscape and the personal in a way that's very, again, ranges from the serious to the witty and just perfectly Keith. This all over pattern, almost a decorative wallpaper, I call this penis wallpaper effect, that he can go from that to an image like the work on the right, which is untitled, but is more typical of his signature style as later really pared down line images that get at what's essential about the human experience and not in a way that's always direct or didactic. I mean, in this case, I've described this work, which is mural size and really lovely. If anybody, if you saw the show in Brooklyn, this was the piece that we opened the show with, and it's on paper, it's wall size, and so it really breathes and has a life of its own. but we call it the Medusa tree. I mean, you see almost the heads, the germ of the barking dogs that become part of his iconic imagery, and these universal figures along the bottom, which, again, their activity is not specified. Are they moving away from or towards the tree? And then this very ritualistic image in the center, which could be taken from breakdancing, mosh pits. There's definitely a pulling from popular culture and the dance culture, the nightclub culture that he was so open to and participating in. But then you still see, again, that the careful kind of, again, almost compulsive treatment of pattern as this thing that connects the energy. The energy is connected throughout his work, whether it's a descriptive work or it's a decorative piece. You see that same kind of pulsing energy throughout. And this, the piece on the right also has, I think, what he really responded to when, again, immediately was fell in love with the graffiti that he saw on the subways and on the walls of New York City. That bold black line that outlines so much of graffiti art was this kind of a connection he felt, like, wow, I'm doing the same thing, because his work didn't come out of nowhere when he came to New York. There was a sense of a fish coming to the ocean and becoming part of something that really has to do with a universal experience. So the same bold black graphic line that you find in graphic design and advertising, he was seeing in graffiti art and also in, studying a very careful student, very earnest student of modernist art history, looking at people like Jean Dubuffet and Pierre Alechinsky, who were working in a similar vein. And again, just to point out, I think it's important to note that, Keith represents so much of what the downtown scene was at this time, but he wasn't a blank slate when he came to New York. He was actually already a very mature practicing artist. This work on the left is dated June 4th, 1978, so actually before he came to New York City. and you can see he already has this very confident, very graphic, abstract pattern that he's working with in a way that if you've seen videos of him, painting, it was a very physical, again, almost a ritualistic dance performance for him, what he called a full body painting, where he wanted to use every piece of himself and all of his limbs to get his message across. And a work like this, I believe the dimensions were 29 feet tall, so it's quite sweeping. and it's just, again, it's on paper, and he often worked from paper that he found was discarded. He liked paper because it wasn't overly important, and he considered his art and all art a process, not this perfect finished product. It has a very textile quality. It moves, and you can see it unframed, and it'd be really awkward to frame a piece of this size. So it retains a lot of the feeling, the surface quality ripples a little bit with the air currents. And I think this piece on the left also really displays some of his range in terms of that very signature geometric graphic symbols that he was generating. And if you look at his notebooks, this goes all the way back to when he was a teenager. He was very interested in language as symbol and pictures as language. And communicating is a big theme that, again, connects all of his work. So you have that in this almost like a textile tapestry effect with then very gestural. Obviously, he's looking as well at abstract expressionism and the idea of gestural painting and the energy, the act of painting being recorded in these red, really active brushwork. But my favorite part about this piece is this almost a prototypical public service announcement kind of message at the bottom that I think I take it as almost a faux naive statement on the vein of Huckleberry Finn. Everybody knows where the meat comes from. It comes from the store, right? So he was a thinking individual, and he, again, throughout his work, wanted to just poke people, wake people up, and make them think about where does your meat come from? And again, this is 1978. This is a big topic of conversation nowadays, where you know the politicization of how meat is made, how food is made, and but again, for his age and his time, a very prescient kind of concern for the larger community and the world that he lived in. And I just put up this other work on the right because again, it's different. A lot of his early work, it's very much a workshop for different explorations of everything that I think, again, in this year 1978, when he's first at SV, it's very much about abstraction and not narrative storytelling. But what are all the different possibilities of communicating through abstraction? And I just like the kind of seething, roiling energy of this very compact work. It's a small, you can see the perforation there came out of a small sketchbook that's still very concerned with line and movement. And then just kind of to walk through his development, he's a very restless, very prolific, and I think everybody who knew him or worked with him describes this really tremendous output that he was capable of and the level of intensity to everything that he did. 1979, he starts to shift away from abstraction into really intensive studies of written language and text and poetry. And again, these interests go way back, but it's like he just shifts focus and concentrates for almost all of 1979 on videos and collage work and graphic work that is text-based and, again, playing with the idea of text as image, as abstraction. And this is also coming out of his studies of, you know, semiotics and the whole idea of language being able to be treated as something abstract, and it's a performance between and among us. So again, weaving really beautifully with his interest in the organic and the body, these things are all connected in his work. So you see here, like, he's got the whole series of work in this time period around the germ of it's in his notebooks here, Art Boysen, Fat Boysen, Art Boysen, If, and then on the right, this is an installation view from the show that we had in Brooklyn. Here's a video where he's doing the same thing, not the same thing, but he's moving language around, basically making it down into its basic parts and playing with it as a performance. And then another piece here, phonics, where he got his friends to participate in this sort of performative interaction with text and language. and again, there's so many great moments in this really rich period, but one of the really pivotal points, I think, in his development of his visual language is the show that he did at PS 122, which, of course, is now an official nonprofit art space, but at the time was just an abandoned elementary school where artists made it happen. They used it for studio space and put on shows there. So again, 1980, he's 22 now, and he's just left or leaving SVA kind of having gotten everything he can from that, and he's making so many other things happen that really wanted to question that need to go about achieving greatness as an artist through official means. So he left his art school, and here's a show, a shot from the installation on the left. We were lucky enough for this exhibition that just came down in July to have many of the works, not all, but a lot of the works from this actual show. So, and I'd like to just give credit to our exhibition designer who meticulously arranged the works. You can see how the glory hole and the spaceship that's, you know, zapping the skyscraper there are flanking a window in PS 122 classroom. And we recreated that window. We cut a window into one of our walls because the spaces are so long. It was a lot of work to pack in there. So kind of trying to go back to the architectural, you know, original scene that the show was. And you see the way that Keith hung the show was very densely packed, again, like his energy and his interests, so that when you came into the space, you would have be consumed and surrounded by this plethora, this sea of imagery that didn't necessarily, at this stage, he's not trying to make a really direct public service message, or, you know, a lot of people came to the show and said, where's Keith, the AIDS activist? And that comes about later, I think, in the mid to late 80s. He becomes very much, very happy to and very willing to connect himself directly with public service message and issues of social justice. In this stage, it's almost this just cacophony of ideas that he's generating, and they're open-ended. It seems to all be about being human in one regard or another. And this is, again, I think Patti and Hal will probably talk a lot about his collaborations and what a connector Keith Haring was. He, not only was he busy doing shows of his own and making shows happen at SVA in any space that he could find, he was curating shows at Club 57, he was involved in shows at the Fun Gallery and the Mud Club, and he was making a lot of things happen for a lot of people. And again, what I detect is a great generosity of, instead of just making opportunities for himself or positioning himself forward in the New York art world, which he, you know, eventually did go down a more conventional route. But this period and this time and place was about do-it-yourself, short-term, 24-hour shows, shows that would be open calls for work and would bring together performance artists, musicians, poets, dancers in a way that allowed for all sorts of things to happen collaboratively. So what you see here, again, if you didn't see the show, this is an, basically continuing from Keith's interest in pattern decoration, we created a wallpaper essentially out of all the flyers that he handmade, created very ad hoc for different shows that happened around New York. And so the background are reproductions of all of those posters, collages, handbills that he generated, and then the originals are framed there. And each one in themselves is almost a little gem to take a closer look at. But I just put a close-up of this one on the flyer for a show that Haring was involved in. Again, very early on in his, he hasn't really become an international sensation. The subway drawings are not, again, a phenomenon that's really on the map, but this is a show where you see he's using his signature, his pictographic imagery that he used most often. You know, there's a whole range from all kinds of animal life to references to technology and, you know, outer space. Sex, birth, death, life, and violence. But the barking dog and the baby sort of came down to be his most essential iconic identifiers, almost in the vein of a tag for a graffiti artist. Keith had a great deep respect for graffiti artists. He didn't himself consider himself a graffiti artist. He didn't work much in the vein of, with spray paint, wasn't most comfortable with that. But again, obviously very much informed and very much a product of, he considered himself a link in a chain of related artistic output. But I like this piece in particular because you see he's got the date of the show opening that he's typed over and over again. And again, in this time period, he loved the typewriter, he loved the photocopier, he loved kind of technology, and then at the same time had a healthy wariness about what the place of creativity and independent thinking in a technological age. But he creates this really dense pattern out of the typewritten word in a way I think that is similar, in a way that communicates the same kind of energy that a small, again, this work on the right, which dates from 1977, so again, before he comes to New York, he's generating all of this imagery that's, again, almost, if you pull out those little glyphs, they look almost like somewhere between abstraction and language, where a lot of his interests were. And I just close with this image, which, again, is sort of a tribute to the broadness of the culture. In this section of the show, we call it the vibrant nightlife, and there's a lot of documentary photographs of all the characters and the players that Keith loved and spent his time with and really helped create who he was. And you see on the left, again, video is something that I think he's became better known as someone who worked on videos for music videos for other people and contributed to. But in this early period, he was really putting himself in the middle or using video in a very creative, experimental way. So on the left, for instance, the video of Klaus Nomi performing Lightning Striking, again, a really early window on somebody who became a legend and really a groundbreaking type that was lost really early on. And on the right, it's hard to see here, but Keith himself doing a tribute to Gloria Vanderbilt, which is, again, pulling on his desire to be, you know, it's this mix of shy and extroverted and performative. And he gets up really close to the camera and kisses it, and it's, you know, it's referring to the whole advertising machine that made Gloria Vanderbilt jeans a household name, and, you know, Madison Avenue selling jeans through sex. And so a very thoughtful, complicated person and body of work. And I just want to close by saying that I think that there's a really interesting way in which Keith's work and his way of creating work and bringing people together embodies Joseph Beuys's concept of social sculpture and the idea that society itself is a work of art, and you just have to bring it out and make it happen. And we're lucky that we had him for as long as we did doing that. Thanks.
Our next speaker is Hal Bromm.
Hi, and thanks for coming. It's really great to see so many people who are keenly interested in Keith. And I think he was a very exceptional guy who had a demeanor that was fascinating to me, because he was, as you've just heard from Tricia, who saw this through his work, he was someone who was both a bit shy and a bit introverted, but at the same time, an out young gay guy who was treating New York like his oyster. And he was a student at SVA, and I didn't know Keith, but I had seen these extraordinary black and white drawings in the subway. They were blackout blackout paper covering ads in the subway. And Keith had the brilliant idea to take white chalk and to draw on these black framed vacant ad spaces in the subway. And I think that particular approach to how he would get his art to people free, no charge, if you were on the subway, you could see it. I think that really helped people get to know who this guy was. And of course, the first reaction that I had, and my friends and colleagues were sort of scratching our heads saying, you know, who is this? What is going on here? There's this amazing art in the subway, and it's just there. And then it would disappear because people would rip it off and take it home. And then there'd be another one, and then there would be dozens of them. It turned out that a friend of mine, a great artist who I've worked with, Lucio Pozzi, who's at the moment in Italy, was a teacher at SVA, and Lucho was a professor of Keith's, and Lucho happened to be one of the people that I talked to, and I said, you know, we've got to find out who's doing this stuff because he's really good, and that's how I got connected to Keith. Keith, as a student at SVA, was very industrious. He had a very strong work ethic. Remember, you've heard from Tricia that he came from Kutztown, Pennsylvania. He grew up in a good middle-class family. He was at school in New York. He took it seriously, and he worked hard. But he got to the point of feeling that maybe real life was ready for him and that he didn't need to be there anymore. And he went through kind of a tough time with leaving SVA or trying to stay and get a degree. You know, we're all turned toward the idea that you have to get a degree or maybe two or three. Lucho Pozzi said, look, you don't have to worry about that. If you feel you're done, it's okay. So he left SVA with Lucho's blessing, and I got in touch with Keith because I really wanted to show his work at my gallery. I loved what he did, and when I met him, I loved it even more because I loved Keith as a person. He was so full of energy, and yes, he was a party guy, and yes, he was taking advantage of New York City, but he was a worker. He didn't fool around. He was very serious about his art, and he was very serious about, as you've heard, about promoting his friend's art. And it was a pleasure to see that in somebody who was young, who had left school, but he, you know, I just think he knew where he was going. And I remember going to his studio on Christie Street to start to put together the show that we would do. And the slide you're looking at, by the way, is Keith at the gallery in 1981, standing in front of a window frame that he'd drawn or painted on. And I want to give credit. All the photos you will see were taken by his good friend, Cheng Kuang Chi, who sadly is no longer with us, but a very talented artist in his own right, who was focused on photographic work. In any case, there I was at the studio, and it was in the morning, and Keith had all kinds of great work. And one of the things that some of you may have seen up at the Met Museum in the show about Warhol's influence on contemporary art, there's a wonderful piece of Keith's that's a poster of Elvis Presley. And then over that poster, Keith has drawn in the heavy black line that has become, of course, his iconic trademark, radiating symbols and lines. And it's a beautiful piece. But that there was another one at his studio of Marilyn Monroe that's not in the Met show. I remember enjoying those, but we decided they wouldn't be in the show because they were a little different than pieces that Keith had made completely on his own rather than altering someone else's image. The doorbell rang, and it was Jean-Michel Basquiat. And Jean-Michel was, of course, someone I'd heard about and whose work I had also seen a little bit of and liked. But in came this guy who was really great, we had a nice talk, and he and Keith talked about the work we were looking at, and then he said, oh, I have something special, and he reached into his pocket and pulled out a joint the size of a little cigar, and keep in mind, this is, you know, before lunch. Anyway, Keith and I didn't let that distract us from the work at hand. And in December of that year, 1981, we did the show at West Broadway. And I'll take you through a few other slides that will show you a little bit more of what was in the show. This is Keith hamming it up for Kuang Chi at the window. This is a little piece that we sold to a private collector, borrowed back for our 30th anniversary show. This is one of his Sumi ink on paper drawings. And you see all the usual imagery that everyone is now familiar with. In the foreground is a baby crib. It's another shot of it. And I was very curious about this because it had not been at the studio and it was not a piece that we had picked out for the show. But Keith appeared with it and said, do you think it'll work? And I said, it's amazing. Of course, we'll put it in the show. And this piece, like the one here on the windowsill, these were both found objects. And Keith was very keen on wandering around the street and finding things and turning them into works of art. In this case, this was a drawer from a desk. And the bottom of the piece is on which it stands is actually the face of the drawer, and the tall part that's the image you're looking at is actually the bottom of the drawer. And it was done on both sides. We don't have a shot of the other side. But I asked him about the crib, and he said, well, I found it on the street, and I really wanted to do it. And what he didn't tell me that I discovered later was the crib has an inscription on it. And the inscription reads, to Juan, who I love so much, owe so much. And then later I asked him about it. And it turned out that the crib was actually done by Keith for his lover, Juan. And I was very moved by that. And years later, a woman called Alicia Beldegreen was doing a book called The Bed. And she'd heard about this piece. And we got together and she wanted to put it in the book. And I said, make sure that you identify what it says on the crib, because I wanted that sentiment that had gone into making this piece to become part of the history of the work. And she did, happily. So that's it of the pieces in the show. Once the show was open, I got in touch with Ruth LaFerla, a gifted writer who was writing at that time for a Fairchild publication called Daily News Record. This was a kind of menswear thing that John Fairchild had dreamed up to promote men's fashion. And Ruth was very intrigued by Keith, and I got them together, and she did a wonderful interview with him. Somewhere in our archives, we have copies of it, and if I'd really been organized, I would have brought them for all of you tonight. But maybe we'll get it posted online to share with people. We did a web search and could not find anything in the DNR archives about that. But it's a really, really interesting piece. Tricia, did you ever hear about it? Yeah, I think you'd find it fascinating. As you heard from Tricia, Keith was very fond of collaborating. And another gay artist who was openly gay was Andy Warhol. And Andy was totally intrigued by Keith. And as you may know, they did some collaborations together. And I think the Met show has done very well curatorially to include that Elvis piece, because it absolutely shows the way someone like Warhol influenced Keith, not derailing him from his own images and concepts, but letting him do something that was absolutely influenced, I think, by the way Warhol worked, which was to take existing images and play around with them. Basquiat, of course, also worked with Warhol, and GVSHP, who've done a wonderful job with presenting public events such as this one, have an event coming up focused on Basquiat, and I'm sure that many of you will be interested in that. David Wanarovich was an artist I worked with who was very much a contemporary of Keith's, but not a close friend. They were both gay, both young guys, and both came up out of the East Village scene. They were both at the same clubs. They were both doing work in a lot of pop-up, what we now call pop-up shows. But they were from very different backgrounds, and I think that may be why they were not so closely connected personally. David was an abused kid who ran away from home when he was a teenager. and ended up in New York pimping, hustling on Times Square. Keith, as you know, grew up in a good middle-class family and came to New York with college door open to him. David never went to college. He was a self-taught artist. And so the work is very, very different. But I think these are two young gay artists who really blazed new territory in terms of what you could do as a gay person making art. If we think back to Warhol, or we think back to, let's say, Jasper Johns or Bob Rauschenberg, both gay artists who were very, very gifted, but never really were very open about their sexuality, certainly were not allowed, given the societal structure that they worked and lived in, when they were Keith or David's age, they were not allowed to do things that Keith or David took for granted. And I think that's an important thing to think about when you look at art by these people. The fun, very patternistic penis drawings, of which there were many in the Brooklyn show, are, you know, yeah, the image starts with, you know, a penis, but they're much more than that. But the levity that Keith could approach creating that imagery could not have been done in the 50s or 60s. In 1980s, yes. And of course, if we fast forward to today, there's a whole new level of freedom that young gay artists can enjoy. But I think it's just worth noting that, you know, they were able to do something that couldn't have been done even 20 years prior. I'm not going to ramble on because you're going to hear some good things from Patti. But I hope you'll have good questions and comments during the end of our talk. Thanks.
So our final speaker is Patti Astor.
Thank you. It's great to see all of you out here. Keith would be very happy. I'm sure he is. Something I always remember about Keith is I read somewhere that he read about Andy, first found out about Andy Warhol in a church magazine in Kutztown. And I just always loved that fact. And I used to tease him about being from Kutztown. He used to get so mad. I said, Keith, I'm from Cincinnati. I'm just teasing you. And he was, no, I'm a New Yorker now. I think to set the scene, since we are talking about the East Village, to go back, kind of structure what the whole history of the art scene and creative scene in the East Village, because I was lucky enough to get there under 75, 76. When I moved over there, people said, that's it, goodbye, we'll never see you again because you were never coming over there and you're going to get killed anyway. Actually, it wasn't really that bad. It was a bunch of, you know, small neighborhoods. I mean, beyond Avenue A was a total war zone. I mean, it was really bad over there, very bad heroin. And a lot of people, to fast forward a little bit, when Fab and Lee and Futura got their studio after they had come down at 5th and C, I used to hang out there and I used to like, oh, there's going into the getting some heroin. Okay, that's good. Anyway, it was pretty dangerous. But if you stuck around, I lived on 10th and 2nd, and people were like, it's so dangerous over there. So, but what the first era, I divide the East Village into three eras. So that 75 to 77 was CBGBs, it was punk rock. And that was the first kind of, everybody just ran around. We stayed up until like 6 in the morning every night, hanging out. And again, the punk rock was, the punk rock really fueled a lot of the rest, a lot of the scene that was to come, because punk rock was do it yourself. Pick up a guitar, 1, 2, 3, 4, you got a band. And that scene kind of peaked when, I mean, that was when CBGB's, Blondie, when I first moved over here, Blondie and the Talking Heads were the house bands at CBGB's. I was a kid, I was 25. We just used to go there and hang out for $2 beers and, you know, see if Patti Smith was there. And also at that time, interestingly enough, the Soho scene was really big, and the people that I had met, Duncan Hannah, Stephen Kramer, Amos Poe, who did a famous movie called Blank Generation and would put me in my first film, 1976, Unmade Beds, and Duncan Hannah were pretty upwardly mobile, and along with Eric Mitchell. So they took us, they dragged us down to Soho to, like, let's see if we can see Warhol, let's see the Warhol stars. And Stephen, who became my husband, and I were like, okay, they have free drinks, we'll go. So that was kind of the first era. And that era kind of ended when Talking Heads and Blondie got their record deals, and that kind of moved on. And but from that scene became the underground film scene. And so for the next 2 years, from like 78 to 80, everybody was running around, you know, and again, everybody was just, would just pitch in. I mean, if you see some of these movies, like the cast of Rome 78 is just about every single person that was in the East Village, John Lurie, James Chance, Anya Phillips, Christian Hoffman, and they're all running around wearing togas with smoking cigarettes and wearing penny loafers. We all lived in these really crummy apartments that had tub-in kitchen. So for Rome 78 in particular, it was really atmospheric because you just could shoot. You shot in the apartment, but you left the water on, so it sort of gave you this bath kind of thing going on. So the movies, that was kind of the thing for the next 2 years. And then when Jim Jarmusch broke out with Stranger Than Paradise, we're like, okay, what's going to happen next? So I was walking across Astor Place, and this young gentleman wearing these really distinctive day-glow glasses, they were painted, he painted them himself, was, you know, just walked up to me and had a little camera, and he said, "Hi, I'm Keith Haring. Can I take your picture?" And I said, "Sure, I think that would be fun." And that was a very lucky day for me, because that's when Keith and I became friends. And you have to understand that at the time, it was just, everybody was just, I mean, one of the reasons we didn't see graffiti art until it came down to see us was that we didn't really even take the subway that much. You just could walk everywhere. You could walk just, you know, from 14th Street to Soho, you could pretty much walk everywhere. And, I mean, we were living in these awful apartments on East 3rd Street. About six of us lived there. John Lurie, Tina Lahotsky, Bill Rice, myself, Eric Mitchell, Michael McLeod, and they're these horrible $65 a month apartments across the street from the men's shelter, but they were $65, and we never paid the rent anyway, so we, well, my whole ceiling fell in my bedroom, so I wasn't really, and they never really did anything about it, so we used to call that the Street of the Stars. So I did, and but that was the atmosphere there was just, still, because everything was so cheap, that you could do whatever you wanted to. You didn't have to. I mean, I feel sorry for these kids today that have to pay this huge rent. I mean, I feel sorry for me. you know, you could do those kinds of things. And we had the clubs. We were just kind of, it was just a big playpen, and it was very supportive atmosphere. And then the next thing that happened was I had this movie called Underground USA, which was the punk rock Sunset Boulevard, and it was running as a It ran for 6 months as the midnight movie at the St. Mark's Cinema, now a Gap. And there was this poet, Duncan Smith, and it's I have to say, I mean, I'm not even going to bother to say, most of these people are gone from us. And that was a tragedy that we'll talk about a little bit later. Duncan Smith, this is so typical of what the East Village was like at this time. Duncan Smith, who was a poet philosopher, was having a 100th birthday party to celebrate the birthday of Stephen Mallarmé, the poet. And a whole bunch of us came down there, and he served vodka and cucumber sandwiches. And Diego Cortez was there with this tall black guy wearing the pork pie hat and the shades. And the guy came up to me. Of course, no one would introduce us. They were too cool. He came up to me with a paper plate. And it was Fab Five Freddy. And he said, "Patti, Astor, you're my favorite movie star. Can I have your autograph?" And again, I said, "Well, yeah, you must be my new best friend." And that's what happened. So it was a great feeling of just everybody like coming. And the graffiti art really brought this incredible energy to the scene. I mean, these guys, we were like, you know, running around, like doing little, you know, like performances at clubs. These guys were going out like bombing subway trains in the middle of the night up in the yards. And we really got, I think that that also what we had in common was is that the subway guys were, again, they were making their own personas. They were making their own culture because the city had given up on them. And I think that we also, on the art side of it, we were like, the Soho scene was way overblown. We weren't really interested in all this artwork that you had to go to art school to pretend to understand. It just did not connect with us. You have to understand, too, that at the time, the art world was completely closed. There was white wine, white walls, and white people. And I really think that the big contribution that I think that Keith was, I think Keith was our leader, along with Fab, that we opened the art world up to everybody. And that was what Keith loved to do. One of the first things I remember about him was handing out the buttons, the little, you know, radiant baby, and then he would do a series of buttons, but he just loved to be able to give someone something. You know, you can be part of this. You don't have to be put off because you didn't go to an art school, because you don't have money. Just come on down, you know, you can be part of it. And with the Fun Gallery, we had that same feeling because, you know, the Fun Gallery was a total accident, and I know nothing about the art business, okay? But whatever, it happened. So, and people would come in. At this point, you know, people would bring in their slides. I was actually in a Star with a kid waiting on me the other day, and I said something about a slide, and he said, "What's a slide?" Okay, but back then, you know, we would come around with slides, and I just made a policy. First of all, I was too busy, and secondly, didn't interest me for someone to come in with a package of slides and tell me how great their art was and how it could sell and everything like that. And I said, "You're in the wrong place. What you need to do is go down to Houston Street and see that huge mural that Keith Haring did with all the neighborhood kids that would just show up whenever Keith said he wanted to do something and pitch in, roller the whole wall and do whatever he wanted them to do. That's Fun Gallery. Go out and do something and then come back and see me." And Keith was absolutely the embodiment of that. Keith was hugely responsible for the crossover that did take place in the most important show. There was the Times Square show, which is a funny story. Mark, did the Times Square come before Beyond Words? I think so, right? Yeah. The Times Square show is this big show that was organized by Fashion Moda, who did also come before Fun Gallery. And it was just, they just took over this big, huge porno shop, theater, whatever, and it was just like kind of open season. It was... anybody could come in. Keith, it was the collab. Collab took it. Collab was always had a little trouble with us because we didn't have any rules. They got mad when Kenny Lee went out of his space. That was good. Anyway, they're Fab and Keith don't know each other, and they're standing in front of Fred's painting in the show. And Keith says, "You know," he says to Fab, Fred, he says, "You know, I've heard a lot about this guy. He's supposed to be really cool." And he's talking to Fred. He says, "I love this work. Do you know this guy?" And some girl comes up to Fred and goes, "Fred, can I have your autograph?" So that was embarrassing. But then they became really good friends. But the most important show was Keith got a job with, or got the assignment. I seriously doubt he ever got paid anything, to curate the fourth floor of the Mud Club, which had been, and also during that whole time, the Mud Club was like the center of action. And again, the Mud Club was, Tina Lhotsky was queen of the Mud Club. You could do just about anything there. As long as you know you had a plan and you carried it through, it would be fine. You could do anything you wanted. And so Keith got this thing to curate the fourth floor of the Mud Club, and he did this show called Beyond Words. And Beyond Words was the first show where downtown and uptown really came together, downtown. Africa Bambaataa was the DJ. Iggy Pop and Alan Vega from Suicide had artwork. John Michel and the Futura, Zephyr, Lee, all these people that we'd never heard of. It's so hard to think about it now, but in 1980, no one had ever heard of any of the hip hop culture aspects, the breakdancing, the graffiti art, the music. It was, you just didn't hear anything about it, and then all of a sudden, boom. And Beyond Words was a big factor in that. That was the first time that I had seen all this work, and it was the first time I saw the culture, which was 12-year-old kids running around with their backpacks full of Krylon cans, you know, and they were just stopping by before they were going out to bomb the yards. And you can hear that because the little balls inside the cans are shaking, and like as soon as like people would hear that, they're like point, you know, they're like ears would prick up, and that'd be like somebody had racked and somebody was going out to bomb the yards. And Keith curated that show, and he was just always really so generous with sharing the vision that art is open to everyone. He really wanted everyone to be involved. He always made things to give away, and he was also one of the first people to open up Soho to play the music. Nobody ever did that before. At his show at Tony's, he rocked the boombox. We did it at the Fun Gallery, but we were trash. His incredible energy with the subway panels. My friend and colleague, Anita Rosenberg, who has many, many pictures of that era, she lived uptown on Lexington in 86, and everybody was friends by now. And he said, and she always had her camera, which thank goodness she did, because she has incredible amounts of images. And he said, what subway stop do you live at? And she said, oh, Lexington 86. He said, fine. The next day she came down to her subway stop. He knew she went down every day because she went to NYU Film School. And all the subway panels were pictures of guys with cameras and just a whole variation on that thing. And that was Keith. And it was also the spirit of the time. It's like, oh, let's do something. Okay, let's do. You know, let's just do it. Another famous show that he put together was the Black Light Show at Club 57. And you just announce you're having the show. That's fine. He covered all the walls of the Club 57, which was a downstairs basement. It was underneath the Ukrainian church. And somehow Ann Magnuson and Susan Hannaford, and I can't remember the other guy's name right now, somehow they talked them into like letting them have this club there. So it was just, again, just put up the paper, and everyone came in during the day and did their blacklight things, and then the nighttime came and Jean-Michel Basquiat DJ'd. We all took mushrooms, and it was great. The Fun Gallery started that same way. Keith was there. Futura offered to give me a painting, and I realized at the time that a mural, I was starting to get like hip, that a mural was much more prized than a painting, because a mural was yours. It could never be bought or sold. And Futura said, you want to do a, I said, why don't you do a mural? And I was still on the East 3rd Street apartment. I said, why don't you do a mural at the East 3rd Street apartment? And you'll paint it in the morning, and in the afternoon we'll have an art opening and barbecue. And so, and Kenny Scharf had just started customizing all of his appliances. Customizing appliances, he called it Van Chrome, which meant you take a blender and you paint it and you stick all these little cowboys and rocket ships and stuff like that on it. Now it was a Van Chrome. So we did that. And then everybody came over in the afternoon, and I remember Keith was at the window. You could see outside. And, you know, Dondi was there, Fab was there. And we're all, you know, drinking cheap beer and eating ribs. And Keith was at the window, and he goes, and excuse my language, with this direct code, he goes, oh, shit. And we all rush over to the window. And there's Diego Cortez and Jeffrey Deitch getting out of a cab, coming to this art opening barbecue that was just completely downtown, you know, spur of the moment thing. I mean, it was never... And I know this sounds hackneyed, but we really never thought about anything but making great art. And there was no like differentiation between your life. I mean, people go like, well, what did you do? Like, I said, there was just no differentiation between it. You know, if I was making Snake Woman, I was Snake Woman. And, you know, Keith's art just extended throughout his life. There was never like any turn, you know, always turning it off or anything like that. It was just all one seamless, just really tremendous, you know, body of work. And I was talking about it with Kenny Scharf, who thank goodness is still with us, when we were doing Art in the Streets out in LA. And we were both in the, I had a fun gallery out there. And, you know, and Kenny, I said, you know, Kenny, we ended up talking about it. We just said, you know, it's the people who really don't care that are the best artists. And I don't mean that they don't really care about what they're doing, but they don't second think themselves. You know, it's just a pure flow. I call these artists naturals. And a lot of the people that I had were naturals, and Keith was, you know, a wonderful natural. Anyway, to move on. Oh, so then Jeffrey Deitch and Diego Cortez were getting out of the cab. We were so shocked, but it was kind of an interesting, it was one of those moments where you went, I think, you know, to quote Fab Five from Wild Style, maybe it's about time we start making some money from this rap shit. All right. Anyway, like to go, just to show how generous Keith was, he was already pretty established by the time we had the Fun Gallery. Although we did find some good pieces, because there was a famous, the original Fun Gallery was very small when it measured for the rug, which I had to have rug. It was 8 feet by 25. And it was on East 11th Street between 2nd and 3rd. And right around the corner from there was what became a very famous hip hop club, the Club Negril. So everybody would come over to the Fun Gallery first, have their giant spliefs that Hal saw. And then go to Negril. It would be like so great. And then Bill and I would stay, you know, to like lock up, and we'd be walking down the, you know, half a block. There'd be like, Bill got a fabulous Keith Haring that was on a shutter, because these guys would go on anything. And there was also another interesting thing too, that the graffiti, whole graffiti thing, I think brought out, was that, again, there's no rules. It doesn't have to be this white canvas and this and that and all. You can be anything. If you feel that it's art, that's all that's really important. And you're trying to express yourself and make the world a better place. That's all that's important. And this is from Keith's show at the Fun Gallery in February of 83. Keith had always wanted to do something. This is our second gallery. This was the big one that was on East 10th Street. It was a double storefront. So we actually had a nice space. It's very rare in that neighborhood to get a double storefront. And so Keith decided that, you know, he said, I want to do a show with you. And he also gave us, when we first moved over there, because the building was an absolute wreck, he gave us a beautiful Sumi ink on hot pink with a hot pink frame around it to sell for, you know, just get the gallery started. Of course, the first thing that happens is the dealer walked in the door. What's my discount on that? There isn't one, okay? But anyway, he was working with LA 2 at the time, so they did. That is spray paint on the walls. They spray painted, because this was the Fun Gallery. The Fun Gallery was the artist gallery. You could do whatever you wanted to. It was your call. You could do your invitation. Whatever installation you wanted to do, that was fine. We actually got the name from Kenny Scharf. At one point, they were going to be able to name the gallery, and Kenny called it the Fun Gallery. And then Fred was next and wanted to call it the Serious Gallery. And I was like, no. Okay, so we just kept the Fun Gallery. But anyway, he and LA too painted this entire thing with spray cans. They didn't even have a paint thing. And it was February, so when they finished up, we were all like so buzzed. The fumes were unbelievable, and you know, because of course no one was wearing masks or gloves or anything like that, which is another problem. They even painted all the snow outside, and that sweatshirt that I'm wearing, he also painted. Keith made 1,000 posters for that show for us to give away, and he's signing black books. This is a typical scene at the Fun Gallery. This is every day. These kids would come down with their black books hoping to see their heroes and talk to them, and because these kids had no place. They had no culture, so they invented their own culture, and Keith loved that culture. It was very, very, he just embraced it, and it was, again, it was kind of the same culture coming together, and then what I did was just other thing. And then this is a glamour shot of by Eric Kroll. And again, you can see this is the corner. You can see, I mean, they didn't just do like doodads. I mean, you can see that the paintings on the wall themselves are incredible. And that's the Smurfs. Of course, he came in with these big pieces of leather, which were beautiful. But of course, we only sold one Smurf. But anyway, I'm going to close, and I'm sure you guys have plenty of questions. It's an honor to be here to talk about Keith.
Okay, we're going to start doing questions. We're just going to ask that if you get called on to ask a question, a volunteer, there'll be one on each side, is going to come to you with a microphone. Since this is being recorded, we want to make sure that everybody can be heard. So, questions?
Thank you. I'd like to comment on what strikes me about it is how urban it is. That it's, you know, even that you can all exist in these few blocks, and it's so densely populated, and you take any available space, and a certain thing of the mix of people, which is a sort of a diversity, a tolerance, that, that I mean, you're talking about it more in terms of, you know, part of the gay scene of the East Village. I mean, I know that sort of historically. But to me, it could also be looked at as a very, just a flowering of creating this neighborhood, right? You're talking about how ugly the apartments are, but in fact, it's that's not ugly, it's beautiful, right? If it was sort of white or graying white, it'd be ugly, but in fact, there's all this color and creativity and sort of like a functional art, like how a piece of craft, it's almost like craft in a certain way rather than sort of fine art. I would like your comment on that. That's how it strikes me.
Anybody else? Right here.
Yeah, on Club 57, I think I may have gone there. Was that a gay club downstairs around 6th, 7th Avenue?
It was on 8th Street. It was on 8th Street downstairs. Yes, it wasn't particularly a gay club.
It's kind of an everything club.
Yeah, it was an everything club. I mean,
everybody.
I think also something that should be that it, when she was talking actually that another interesting thing that happened that I observed was that when all these like homeboys, you know, came down, they were a little dicey with the gay thing. It wasn't, you know, it's sort of, you know, they call them homos and stuff like that. But once they saw these guys in action, that went out the window. And, you know, you had to earn your respect in that world, just like you did in the yards, just like you know, you had to get out there and do something. But the respect was there to be given if you were worth it. And I think that that also really, that really opened up the gay culture to a wider acceptance.
Thank you.
I think we have a question right here.
You have a big enough mouth, so I think you can hear me.
Here we go.
Thank you. I just have a quick question. In terms of Keith and that era and that generation, everybody started off with this creative spirit, and then it seemed like it got a little commercial. And if we look at Romero Brito right now, who is pretty much a direct influence of Keith Haring and his work down in Miami. Everywhere you drive around Miami, you see his work, very colorful, surrounded by the black ink, which is very similar to Keith Haring. And I just wanted to know your feeling on commercial art and young people these days that are looking at artists like Keith Haring and Basquiat and trying to replicate some of what they did or move to the next level. But it's very difficult in the art world because you want to be a commercial artist or you don't. And so I just wanted to know what your feelings are about that.
I think Patti said it best just a few minutes ago, which was that if you're a natural, if you are a natural artist, if you believe that what you're doing is what you want to do, you really don't even think about it. It just comes out naturally. And if you look at somebody like Keith, he struggled with the idea of, should he leave SVA before he got a degree? Was that going to be okay with the rest of the world, with the commercial world? And of course it was fine, but not everybody has that self-confidence or that feeling of what would we call it, that feeling of direction. In terms of commercial, if you think about things like the Damien Hirst auction at Sotheby's, when this artist had the audacity to concoct a one-person auction and got Sotheby's to accept it. I don't know how many of you know that there's a backstory to what that auction was like or what the results of that auction were, but you know, that's commercialism at its height. And I don't know if that helps answer your question, but you know, if we go back to the early 80s or late 70s, commercialism didn't have a leg up on where we are today.
I think that Keith's whole professional life was about, in many ways, he was a gadfly to the art market, and the very act of giving art away, making art that was meant to be ephemeral, and shows that didn't necessarily sustain critical attention, because they happen so quickly, right? I mean, if you happen to have the right people show up, that's great. But he had, you know, I think in the same spirit that a lot of young artists are resisting just taking the traditional track because there's not enough space, right? The kind of the dream has failed for, in post-September 11th world, whether you're an artist or just trying to get a job in general, there's a sense of like there's not opportunities, so you have to find other ways to make things happen. And I think that this is a really pivotal moment. It's been an issue since, in general for artists throughout history that things get copied, co-opted, commodified. And I think that, there's this blend of being willing to share himself. And I think of Keith having maybe given up a career with as a distinctive individual. And I think some of the criticism that you hear about him from time to time is, oh, well, he just found something and he just worked it to death, that it was so, it's so simple, right? But that was a conscious, he's obviously a really complicated, thoughtful, and multidimensional kind of artist who could have continued to be in a political vein, or could have continued to be an abstractionist, a neo-expressionist. There's so many different ways he could have gone, and he chose this path that was, I think, on the razor's edge of being really commodifiable, and he worked that with the pop shop and mechanical reproduction of his imagery and applying it, decorating things in the way that he's quite famous for, and also messing with the market and the system and wanting to, again, be wary of what money can do along with technology to stifle creativity. So I think he's an inspiration for a lot of, obviously, a whole generation of people trying to find their own way.
Tricia, you just mentioned the pop shop, and I think maybe some people here don't know too much about that. Would you all mind commenting on the, telling us a little bit about that?
The pop shop was, again, and Keith got a lot of flack for this, too. And also, you need to remember that. Keith went through some down periods because people were jealous. There was the famous attack on West Broadway with the tar and feathers. These artists threw tar and feathers at him. They just missed Leo Castelli. There's a famous picture of it. No, for real. Because a lot of people, and I would see this too, because I mean, a lot of people obviously are very eager to be artists. And I would tell people, it's a very hard life. Because I had a lot of young kids come in there, and I'd say, and it's a very difficult life. It's not what you see right now, because it was the 80s and there was a lot of money being thrown around. It's not always what you see, but there was this like jealousy and also almost frustration. And Keith did have a backlash at a certain point in his career. Say probably around 84, that's ballpark though. you know, where he wasn't. Everybody is. Oh, he's just like what you were saying, or one of the
too commercial.
Yeah, too commercial, right. Or that's not really art. Well, if it's not art for you, then go someplace else. That's all I can tell you, and I'm sure that's what Keith would tell you too. Because it's not also, I mean, they weren't just throwaway. I mean, Jean-Michel was very knowledgeable about, you know, the art history, and so was Keith, and so were all of these people. But the thing to do is not to copy it. You take it and make it your own and let it inform your own vision. And people, I think now, I saw it so many times, people who think, oh, I'll just kind of do something that looks like Keith Haring and it'll sell. That's not the ballgame.
How many people here remember the Pop Shop?
Oh, I was supposed to talk about the Pop Shop. I got off on something else. Sorry. Thank you, Hal. Good save.
Well, but it seems like there's a pretty good recognition of a lot of people seem to know.
Yeah.
But for those of you who don't, Keith created a storefront in Soho that sold buttons and objects that he had created and then ran off as multiples. And I always thought of it as part of his general trend toward wanting everyone to be able to afford to have something that they thought was art, or that they enjoyed, or they thought was fun. And I think there again, in an artist, a young artist like Keith, you see the influence of somebody like Warhol. Andy was very much an egalitarian in a way about making his art accessible in the very earliest days. I mean, if you hung out at the studio and you did stuff, you ended up with little pieces of art. I mean, it was fine. It wasn't a big deal. He never had a pop shop, but of course he went into business with Fred Hughes as his business manager of doing society portraits, because that was a way for him to fund all the more adventurous stuff.
Yeah,
but you're right. Yeah. Keith took flack for the Pop Shop,
yeah,
which I think was totally undeserved because it was a great thing.
It was because people were jealous. I think another thing that by this time Keith was very successful, and something that Keith would always do is, I mean, he put his money into doing the Pop Shop so that people could, because by that time his artwork to like some, you know, kid off the street was not accessible anymore, and he worried about that. And he did the Pop Shop because that could make his artwork accessible. He would put, like I said, those huge murals that he would do, he would fund those himself, mm-hmm, you know, and he always poured his money back into the community to make sure that his art was being seen and embraced the way that he wanted it to be, which was by everybody.
And I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the Pop Shop was never like a huge profit-making operation. It was almost like an art performance, mm-hmm, on a larger,
yeah,
scale that, again, was not, the mm-hmm intention wasn't to commercialize, but to spread.
Exactly, that's a good point. No, his intention was not to make money with the Pop Shop.
It was not to make money for the shareholders.
Yeah.
And it still exists virtually right through the Keith Haring Foundation, is that?
Well, the Keith Haring Foundation licenses certain products to be made in the vein, again, in the spirit of the Pop Shop. And I think that there are pop-up Pop Shops from time to time. We had a Pop Shop
at the
Brooklyn Museum,
yeah,
in conjunction with the show, and we took flag for that. It's like, well, why, if you can't have, museums are just trying to stay open, again, like it's in the spirit of trying to follow through on Keith's intention. And again, everything that the Haring Foundation licenses, the whole existence of the Haring Foundation goes into AIDS education and children's health charities and benefits. So it's very much, Keith set it up to have that kind of humanistic, philanthropic purpose, and that's what it continues to do.
I think we had a question right over here.
Patti, can you talk about your book a little bit, and where can we purchase it? And
well, I happen to have a picture of the front cover right here.
Which is great.
I don't have the book yet.
Is it coming out?
I'll have them Saturday morning. That's what they're telling me. Okay. This is the cover of my book. This is good because it's called Fun Gallery: The True Story. And this is me in front of Futura's mural at the barbecue. It's gorgeous, absolutely beautiful. And I'm having an opening at Click Gallery on Saturday. And they're also, I did, because this is do-it-yourself, of course. I didn't have any backing. I self-published, and a lot of people have put an incredible amount of work into it. And there's a huge generation now, 30s and in their 30s and 40s that just idolized this era. And an Australian design firm in Australia put an incredible amount of work into this book for free, because they said, we want to help you. We want to help you keep this era alive. And so they did. You can also get the book on the website. And I have cards up here, because we have very few books on Saturday. And it's complicated, but you can buy them on the website. And if you buy them now from me, I will sign them in my little trailer park out in Hermosa Beach and send it to you.
And acting as your agent, I will just let you know
that the
Click Gallery is at 255 Center Street, and it's Saturday at 5?
5 to 8, yes.
So, there you go.
Any other questions? We have time for maybe one more. Okay. Two more. We'll do these last two.
I have a question. After reading about just the success of all of the artists that really stuck together during this time period, it seems that one of the keys to it was the strength in numbers. By sticking together as a group, they were all together able to rise to a good amount of success. Do you think today, this young artist today, if they took on this approach, this, again, strength in numbers, so we can all kind of create a scene around each other, if that would help some artists find success, more notoriety, more just being out there or getting their name, like, again, their art out there with them. And do you think this is something that can be taught or shared, or is this something that comes from within and is...
I don't know the answer to your question, but I think what happened in the East Village was very spontaneous. And the confluence of very cheap real estate, energy by a lot of very talented artists, and then, of course, the public fascination that eventually developed with a new art scene. That's just my perspective, but I remember the big day in the East Village, once it turned into a place that people started to go to look at art, was Sunday. And maybe it's something that could be duplicated, but I think it was very natural the way it came together, and there were factors that were totally societal and of the moment. You can't just make those up.
Yeah, it seems like there's, it depends on what you mean by success, you know, because you can be really, there's a very narrow field of opportunity for a certain number of people to become art stars, but then does that mean that you can't be a successful artist if you're not caught up by the market? And, you know, there are plenty of, like, artist collectives and a lot of do-it-yourself movements going on that reject that narrow path, and I think, again, of, like, Keith Haring and this movement as being like kind of a precursor to street artists of today and artist collectives. And I'm thinking, for instance, of the Bruce High Quality Foundation, which is a collective of anonymous artists. They intentionally keep their identity undisclosed so that they cannot be gain market value in that sense.
They
ironically,
can't be commodified.
Yes, ironically, and if they put on the Bruce Annuals, this, and you know. I think in ways that are very creative and typical of this moment, working against that narrow track, and they've started the Bruce High Quality Foundation University, which is a free and open art school, again, like challenging the whole idea that you have to get an official art education to be trained as an artist. So I think that I feel like it must get harder and harder with the proliferation and globalization and the quick, you know, rise to fame of pop culture coming to even a greater level than it was back then. But smart, creative people that are naturals are going to find ways to redefine success and redefine what the avenues to success are. And you can tell the authentic stuff from stuff that's derivative and pandering to the market. And, you know, yeah, I saw that last year. I saw that. I've seen that before. Like, can you do something different with that, right?
And then I think we just had that one last question back here.
Well, I mean, you kind of touched on it on as far as where she was speaking about success. And economically, though, and maybe comparing to the times of 70s, early 80s, any comment on or advice on artists right now dealing with the economic issue, which is in New York, it's getting really, really hard to get the natural out of you as an artist. Because I think there are lots of naturals, it's just everybody's on a hamster wheel. So any advice on, or maybe more access to knowledge like this, being an institution and getting the naturals from the street, where's that bridge? Or any advice on how to bridge that today? Economically, sorry.
Well, I think, you know, what I'm seeing is the most successful art scene in my terms that I see going on is, again, it's hip-hop culture on the internet is huge. And it was really interesting that the first people that started to utilize the internet were the graffiti artists and artists within that group, because it was free and it was a way to get your stuff out there. I think you have to look in those terms. I mean, you can also do, this is how we started the Fun Gallery. Bill says he's got this place he wants to fix up as a gallery. Do I know any artists? I said, yes, I do, and I need to get them out of my apartment because it's a disaster over there and it's party central. And he said, okay, fine. And so he says, well, here's this little space. I've got it. We'll fix it up and we'll have an art gallery. I said, okay, fine. And we got my, it wasn't actually, and the other thing about the Fun Gallery that I want to point out was that it was never conceived as a graffiti gallery. It was just an art gallery. It was the people that we knew that we thought were doing exciting things. And I think that's why we were successful, because it didn't compartmentalize the graffiti artists and everyone got a one-man show. So everybody was on the same playing field. But Stephen Kramer, my ex-husband, terrific artist, not such a good husband. I couldn't help myself. He did 20 colored pencil drawings. They were gorgeous. He cut the mats himself. We were so broke, we couldn't afford to frame them or anything, so we shrink-wrapped them like record albums. We hung 20 of them on the wall. We sold all of them that one afternoon for $50, and that was $1,000. You know, you need to think, like, it's like the same thing with writing a book. Like, how can I ever sit down and write, like, 200 pages? That's not how it works. You start with one idea, one sentence, and you put another one over there. You build it. And people have to be really creative right now. I mean, I'm financing my own book tour, and I'm going to this big hip-hop thing to judge a graffiti thing out in Missouri. Don't ask. But these guys just, they don't care. They'll just do it themselves. They set up in the middle of, the last thing they did over the summer, and they caught my attention on Facebook, on the internet. It caught my attention, and I started writing them. They just set up this huge thing out on a dam. They all pull their pickup trucks out there and put speakers on it. You've got to think like that, and, you know, and I'm starting to say, you know, I want to finance my own book tour, but I tell people, I said, listen, you know, like this week, I'm doing this event, and I'm doing another event. By the way, there's a great event at the new museum tomorrow where we're going to be Lady Pink, Fab Five, and myself and Mark and Paul Schinkel are talking about their videotapes, which, again, they did back in the 80s, you know, off the cuff. And so you do a little bit here and a little bit there. You don't need to think like, I can't start anything unless I have $10,000. Well, it's not going to happen like that. And that's really not how it ever happens. You've got to, you know, you've got to just start small. Have your friends, you know, over to your house and have a painting competition. Everybody throw money into the pot and see who wins, you know, something like that. Or you can vote. the same thing that happened with us. We did the art opening and barbecue, and all of a sudden there's Jeffrey Deitch picking his way through the bombs because he showed up. You got to do something. You can't sit around and worry about, it's never going to happen for me. It's too hard. Because if it's too hard.
Thank you for coming, everybody. Thank you to our speakers and to the New School.
And let's thank, Pam for her hospitality.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, he's